Welcome back to Nevermind, It's an Interview. With Nirvana's lineup now set, Kurt, Chris, and Dave began rehearsing.
We'd been practicing in this really weird practice space. This man built a studio in his in this like barn in his backyard, but it wasn't a barn. It was this thing that had a studio in it, and then upstairs, his brother lived up there, and he was in this really bad like Howard Johnson's lounge band. Everything is carpeted with this like brown shag carpet, and he even had stage lights in there. And he had a massive PA that he just did not know how to use. And you turn it on, and there's just this huge hiss. And we were practicing a lot, and we were writing a lot of material. We'd write them, they were great for like 2 weeks. Oh my God, this is the best song ever. And we'd forget them. And so then we decided, okay, well, we'll start putting them on cassette. So we started recording them onto these boombox things, and we'd lose the cassettes, you know. And so, I mean, we wrote so much material that we just like forgot about. And every once in a while, we'll like pull one out and turn it around.
While the band was writing and rehearsing, the major labels started taking interest.
They were wining and dining us, and there were some labels. We were impressed by them, but we thought DGC would be the best for us.
Was one of the main reasons because of Sonic Youth?
Yeah, we knew Sonic Youth were happy on there, and we always loved and respected Sonic Youth. So, and there's like all these rumors that we got like $1 million or 700. It was actually even in Spin magazine, it was printed that we got $750,000, and we didn't even get a quarter of that. What we did was, instead of going for the big dough, we went for the strong contract.
Which enables you, like, more freedom.
More percentage points on the record. And there's a lot of clauses in there that are in our favor. Now, if our record would have bombed, we would have kicked ourselves in the butt and said, man, we should have took the cash. But we're not in it for the money. We were in it for, you know, let's put out a record and let's do this thing right.
I really don't know what the definition of selling out is anymore. I guess I really don't care. We haven't compromised. A record label lets us do anything we want. We think on the same level. There's nothing that we've done that could be considered a sellout at all, at least not in my eyes. A lot of people who are calling us sellout, they forget that, you know, the Ramones and the Sex Pistols were on major labels. So it was the Clash, and they all those bands are trying to become big stars. They didn't even deny it. Crap, the Ramones had a movie out after them, you know, to help support them.
You know, I think if you make money and you start voting Republican because you'll get tax breaks and they're the party of the rich, I mean, that's sold out.
In early 1991, Nirvana entered the studio with producer Butch Vig.
Yeah, we worked with him in the springtime when we did that demo that I mentioned earlier. He was just easy to work with, laid back, and really attentive to what's going on. He works hard, but he doesn't work the band hard.
It was about time that the band recorded something. Finally, it had been so long.
It's called Sound City, and the board and the room are really old. The board is from the early 70s.
All the dinosaurs have recorded there. Fleetwood Mac, Cheap Trick.
There's nothing more disgusting than the late 80s or early 90s slick sound. You know, you just can't escape it. No matter how retro and old you try to be, or what kind of old equipment you use, you still can't help but sound new.
We got a warm sound out of that place.
It had been 2 years since Bleach. It had been a while since the band had gone in and recorded a full LP, so it was more of like, wow, okay, we're in the studio, let's just get this done, let's just do it.
We made the record we wanted to make. We didn't want to make the number one record. We didn't want to make some big hit record. We just, you know, that would have been the same record if it was on Sub Pop. One baby!
We'll be right back. That's Drain You, recorded live. Kurt and Dave talk about writing songs.
It's usually done on acoustic guitar, sitting around in my underwear, just picking out riffs, pieces of songs.
Maybe Kurt will come in with a melody, a guitar riff, and show it to us.
We go to practice, and then we play the song over and over and over again.
We just jam. There's no real formula.
Chris and Dave have a big part in deciding on how long a song should be and how many parts it should have. So I don't like to be considered as the whole songwriter, but I do come up with the basis of it. I come up with the singing style during practice, and then I write the lyrics usually minutes before we record. That song really wasn't even written until a week before we went into the studio. And I knew I wanted cello on it, but after all the music was recorded for it, we'd kind of forgotten about putting a cello on it. And we had one more day in the studio, and we decided, oh, geez, we should try to hire a cellist, you know, and put something in. And we were at a party, and we were asking some of our friends if they had any friends who played cello, and it just so happens one of our best friends in L.A. plays cello. So we took him into the studio on the last day and said, here, play something, and he came up with something right away. It just fell like dominoes. It was really easy. The lines in the song are really contradictory, you know, one after another. They're kind of a rebuttal to each line, and they just, it's kind of confusing, I guess. It's just about people and what they're expected to act like. Just because I say I in a song doesn't necessarily mean it's me. A lot of people have a problem with that. It's just the way I write, usually. Take on someone else's personality or character. I'd rather just use someone else's example because, I don't know, my life is kind of boring. So, you know, I just take stories from things that I've read and off the television and stories I've heard and maybe even some friends. All he wants a cracker. I should get off her first. Obviously, I don't like rednecks. I don't like macho men. You know, I don't like abusive people. And I guess that's what that song is about. It's an attack on them. This friend of mine and I were goofing around in my house one night, and we were kind of drunk, and we were writing graffiti all over the walls of my house, and she wrote, Kurt smells like Teen Spirit. And earlier on, we were kind of having this discussion on revolution and teen revolution and stuff like that, and I took that as a compliment. I thought that she was saying that I was a person who could inspire. I just thought that was a nice little title. And it turns out she just meant that I smelt like the deodorant. I didn't even know that deodorant existed until after the song was written.
My father said this to me. I know why you guys have sold so many records. The video shows a bunch of kids trashing a gymnasium. And I mean, that sort of works. Like a Nirvana spokesman of the lost generation. They're telling you to go out and destroy your local gymnasium. I don't see it that way. I mean, like, I don't want to hold the responsibility of being a spokesman for anything. You know, I can barely hold my own. I guess it's flattering, and I guess it's great that it actually sort of gives people a feeling of sort of like breaking out and telling anyone and anything just to fuck off.
So high, scratching up and love myself, better than you, knowing it's wrong.
That's On a Plane, recorded live. Kurt talks about the artwork on Nevermind.
One day, Dave and I were sitting around watching a documentary on babies being born underwater, and we thought that was a really neat image. So we thought, let's put that on the album cover. And then when we got back a picture of a baby underwater, I thought it would look nice for a fish hook with a dollar bill on it. And so the image was born. It's just a rubber monkey that I've had for years. And I took that picture. I was in a bohemian photography stage, you know, taking a bunch of weird arty pictures. That's one of them. It's a collage that I made many years ago. I got these pictures of beef from a supermarket poster and cut them out and made a mountain of beef, and then put Dante's people being thrown into hell, climbing all over it. And that's pretty much it. There's also, if you look real close, there's a picture of Kiss in the back, standing on a slab of beef.
Thirteen minutes and 51 seconds after the beginning of track 12, the band put a secret song on the Nevermind CD. This mystery song didn't make the first pressing, though. Dave explains.
When we got our first CD and popped it in, we listened to it. Oh, let's check to see if the track is there. And it wasn't there. The reason for it, I think the original reason, was because Something in the Way is sort of like your slower whatever song. It's the last song on the record and most likely to be listened to by, like, someone that would have, like, a carousel CD player. And so, okay, why not, like, just screw up their little carousel deal? I was talking to a friend who works in a record store, and he said, a person came in with the CD and said, you know, this thing's screwed up. After the last song, there's like this 10 minutes of dead space, and then this Total Noise song. He wanted his money back. And the person at the stores said, well, I think maybe it was a joke of the band, you know, put it on after. I said, well, I don't think it's very funny, you know, and he wanted his money back. It was just like...
In a moment, we'll find out what's ahead for Nirvana when Nevermind, It's an Interview continues.